Hello everyone and welcome to our online light service from King's Church Mildenhall. Thank you for joining us again today. Whether you're online or if you're booked in to the building itself. Birthdays this week, I've only got one very special person, well to me anyway. Happy birthday to Carolyn Bright, a big 5-0 later on in the week. Have a great week, hun, and weekend too. Now, I'm beginning to look at who might be interested in helping in the Sunday youth ministries when we get a chance to start these again in church. Now, we've got three groups. We have Splash for the little ones, for 4 to 7s. We have Plunge for the 8s to 11s, and we have Quench for the 12 to 16s. Now, those of you that have been involved before, I've already got in touch with you to see if you're interested in this, but perhaps you've never thought about helping with our Sunday youth, being either a helper or even teaching in our groups. If you would like to do this and you haven't done this before, do get in touch with me on email. Just email me at associatepastor@kcm.church, or email the office and that will get to me another way if you're interested in doing this. Now, we're not quite sure when we'll be starting this yet, but I'm beginning to start planning now. And in fact, actually this morning, some of our Quench youth are gathering at a very special location in Hollywell Row. I hope you all have a good time there. Now, we're all hoping, of course, that after the 21st of June, restrictions would all be lifted. Now, if that is the case, our online light service will finish in its current format, and it will be replaced with our recording of the live sermon and the closing minutes of the service itself, similar to what we had before lockdown. Now, if things aren't released, we'll just be carrying on doing what we're doing at the moment. So we'll see what Boris says anyway tomorrow about the future. Now, in a moment, we'll join in with song worship after a short mini movie. And following this, Yvonne Wilkins will be bringing the readings to us for this week. Later on, Eric Normington will be leading us in our prayers, and I will be preaching today. However, before we go any further, let us pray. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the people, sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wonderful works, glory in his holy name. Oh, eternal and everlasting Father, God most glorious, God most exalted, whom we have come to know in Jesus of Nazareth, the rock of our salvation, the cornerstone, chosen and precious in your sight. Lord, bring us together today in the name of Jesus, that in him we might be a spiritual temple, that founded on him we be built together as living stones, that in him we offer to you the spiritual service of praise and thanksgiving, of proclaiming your work and of sharing your gifts. Lord, we just want to give you the glory this morning of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. You never change, you never fail, oh God. True are your promises. True are your promises. You never change, you never fail, oh God. And so we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. Yeah, we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was
Hello, Church. Today I have two readings for you. The first one is from the Old Testament, and you can find it in 1 Kings chapter 17, and I'll be reading verses 7 to 24. Sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him. Go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, "Would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink?" As she was going to get it, he called, "And bring me, please, a piece of bread." "As surely as the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said, but first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. He grew worse and worse and finally stopped breathing. She said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" "Give me your son," Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him on his bed. Then he cried out to the Lord, "Lord my God, have you brought tragedy even on this widow I am staying with by causing her son to die?" Then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried out to the Lord, "Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him." The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. Elijah picked up the child and carried him down from the room into the house. He gave him to his mother and said, "Look, your son is alive." Then the woman said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth." The next reading is from the New Testament, and you can find it in Mark chapter 5, and I will be reading verses 21 to 43. When Jesus had crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders, named Jairus, came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask who touched me." But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet. Trembling with fear, she told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old.
Yes, it's that time for our fantastic Bible facts. Now, today our facts are centered around the locations of our Bible passage today. Now then, first of all, did you know there's a city in Israel called Lod? It's a city 9.3 miles southeast of Tel Aviv in the central district of Israel. And you'll see it right here on the map. Now in 2019, it had a population of over 77,000. Now the Hebrew name Lod appears in the Old Testament as a town of Benjamin, founded along with Ono by Shamed or Shamar. 1 Chronicles 8, Ezra 2, Nehemiah 7 and 11, you'll find that. Now it's also mentioned in Ezra 2 as one of the cities whose inhabitants returned after the Babylonian captivity. Now in the New Testament, the town appears in its Greek form, you see in brackets here, of Lydda. And it's the site of Peter's healing of a paralytic man. And we'll be looking at that passage later on. Now then, did you know there's also a city in Israel called Jaffa? In Hebrew it's Yafo, and it's also called Joppa. It's an ancient port city in Israel. And if we go back to the map again, you'll see Joppa or Jaffa on there. Ancient Jaffa was built on a 40 meter high ridge with a broad view of the coastline, giving it a real strategic importance in military history. It is now the southern and oldest part of Tel Aviv-Yafo. Now, Jaffa is famous for its association with the biblical stories of Jonah, of Solomon, and in the New Testament with Peter, as well as the mythological story of Andromeda and Perseus. Now, also later on, it's famous for something else. Can you guess? I'll give you a clue. It's a fruit. Do you want to have a look? Yes, it's the orange. Jaffa orange. Oh, lovely. They look lovely, don't they? Now, finally, did you know the Sharon Plain is in the central section of the coastal plain of Israel? The plain lies between the Mediterranean Sea to the west, Samaria Hills to the east, from Nahal Tanim, a stream marking the southern end of Mount Carmel in the north, to the Yarkon River in the south. Sharon is also a girl's name, and the Hebrew origin meaning is, of course, a fertile plain. Now, the plain of Sharon is mentioned in the Bible in 1 Chronicles 5, 27, Isaiah in several chapters, and there's also the famous reference to the enigmatic statement or title, the Rose of Sharon from the Song of Songs. Now, translators may have used the word rose to refer to the meaning of the Hebrew word, which is a flower similar to what we know as a crocus or bulb flower like a tulip. Therefore, the Rose of Sharon is not really what we would classify as an English rose, but it could be a plant similar to the hibiscus or a crocus or tulip. And do you want to have a look at a picture? Here we go. Here's a picture. Don't they look lovely? Hey, aren't they pretty? The Rose of Sharon. That's all we've got time for that this week. Next up, Eric Normington will be leading us in our prayers. Thanks, Eric.
Good morning, church. We're going to come to our time of prayer. I'm going to not apologize for this, but I'm going to use a Hebrew word in what I'm talking about this morning. It's a Hebrew word that you've heard before, because Carl has preached on this word. But the word is chesed. Chesed. It's mostly translated as mercy in the Old Testament. And indeed, that in the verse that I'm going to be quoting, that's what it's translated in as in the NIV. But it's a word that's much broader than that. It's not just mercy, which is a legal word. It's a very limited word in one sense. But chesed is much wider than that. It means honouring something, or to favour someone, or to even be generous to someone. But there's one word that really encapsulates it that's fallen out of our English language these days. And it's sad, really, that this word isn't used anymore. The word is loving kindness. So just think of when I use the word chesed, think of loving kindness, not just a kindness, but a loving kindness, a kindness that acts on your behalf. So let's come to our time of prayer. Lord God, we come and we want to thank you for the beauty of the world in which you have placed us. But as we look around at what man has done to your creation, we see much unfairness, injustice, selfishness, wastefulness, even destructiveness in our own nature. And as we open your word, we read that the prophet Micah says these words, "What does the Lord require of you? To do justice, to love chesed, and to walk in humility before your God." Lord, these are wonderful aspirations. They're wonderful ideals to try and achieve. But they all require action on our part and on the parts of our nations and our leaders. It's not enough to be speaking about something, but we need to stand on our feet and do something. This very week, we've seen the most powerful man in the world, the President of the United States, standing less than 3 miles from where I'm standing right now. And as he gathers with leaders from those 7 richest nations in the world, they're coming together to discuss and to share. And Lord, we want to pray for them. We pray that they will do justice, that they will love chesed, that they will indeed walk humbly before their God. So Lord, as they pray, that as they talk about trade, that they will remember there are so many in the world who have nothing to trade with, and they have no resources to change their circumstances either. We pray that as they talk about communications, that they would remember all those in the world who have no voice. We pray for them as they talk about caring for the environment, that they will remember the lives of those who have been devastated and destroyed by the profligacy and wastefulness of the affluent West. We pray as they talk about economic recovery, that they will remember those who have so little to begin with and who have even less now. We pray as they talk about healthcare, that they would remember the millions around the globe for whom healthcare is an invisible dream. We pray for those who talk about the success of the vaccination programs, that they will remember those nations where there is no vaccination center, there are no vaccines to share. We pray that they will remember all of this. Lord, we pray that above all, you will give them generous spirits and tender hearts in all of their conversations, and that you would spur them into action to aid those around the globe who need the support of the wealthier and the more prosperous. And Lord, what we pray for the world's leaders, we also pray for ourselves. There are those in our community who are in desperate need, physical, mental, spiritual. Give us a spirit of generosity and a heart of compassion. Make us the answers to our own prayers, that we may represent the Jesus who healed the sick, who spoke up for the oppressed, and let us do as he did. Lord, let us express your life and fulfill your purpose. Lord Jesus, give us your chesed. Amen.
Thank you.
Now this week we're carrying on our journey through one of the midsections of the book of Acts. Our topic of encounters in Acts, this is part 3. So we'll read first from Acts chapter 9 verses 32 to 42. As Peter travelled about the country, he went to visit the Lord's people who lived in Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas who was paralyzed and had been bedridden for 8 years. Aeneas, Peter said to him, Jesus Christ heals you. Get up and roll up your mat. Immediately Aeneas got up. All those who lived in Lydda and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. In Joppa there was a disciple named Tabitha. In Greek, her name is Dorcas. She was always doing good and helping the poor. About that time, she became sick and died, and her body was washed and placed in an upstairs room. Lydda was near Joppa. So when the disciples heard that Peter was in Lydda, they sent two men to him and urged him, please come at once. Peter went with them, and when he arrived, he was taken upstairs to the room. All the widows stood around him, crying and showing him the robes and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was still with them. Peter sent them all out of the room. Then he got down on his knees and prayed. Turning toward the dead woman, he said, "Tabitha, get up." She opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He took her by the hand and helped her to her feet. Then he called for the believers, especially the widows, and presented her to them alive. This became known all over Joppa. And many people believed in the Lord. Peter stayed in Joppa for some time with a tanner named Simon. So, Peter went to visit the Lord's people. Other translations said the saints in Lydda, a town halfway between Jerusalem and Joppa that was on the coast. We've seen that earlier in the facts, didn't we? He then went to Joppa, and we see this account of some of the amazing things that happened there. Now, Peter, first of all, what happened to that impulsive man, the one who promised everything to Jesus, only to deny him and mess it all up three times shortly afterwards? The man who Jesus had met on the shore in his resurrection form, where he had been forgiven and restored. Now look at what God was doing through him as we see the early church spreading and being encouraged. So he meets Aeneas, paralyzed for 8 years. Quite a difficult situation here for Peter, but Peter strolls in and he says, "Jesus Christ heals you. Get up, roll up your mat." Does it sound familiar, perhaps? Yeah, familiar to the words of Jesus and the actions of Jesus himself. And immediately Aeneas got up, and all those that lived in Lydda and Sharon saw him, turned to the Lord. Wow. Isn't that awesome? It goes on, there's more. In Joppa, a disciple named Tabitha, or Dorcas, became sick and died. Let's have a little bit more look at perhaps Dorcas first before we come back to Peter, shall we? Dorcas had several names. So what? Why is it sort of said that in the scripture? She's known as Tabitha and Dorcas. Well, Tabitha is her Aramaic, her Syrian name, and Dorcas is her Grecian name. Now, both of these names actually mean gazelle, or any small antelope of Africa and Asia, a creature with stunning eyes, swift feet, and graceful movements. Oh, there's a picture there. Aren't they lovely? Now, it was common practice back then to give an animal nickname to a beautiful woman. What would you call perhaps your wife then, if you had to choose an animal? What would I call my wife, Carolyn? Well, I came up with this. Carolyn, my beautiful dolphin. How about that? An intelligent, smiley, kind, beautiful lady who can swim like a fish. Although a dolphin is not a fish, it's a mammal, but never mind. There is something special about my wife, Carolyn. And there was something special about this lady, Dorcas. And that's why we hear those two names. Now, Dorcas was single, possibly a widow. Most commentators think she was a widow or single because there's no mention of man. It's unusual in that time. The passage also, doesn't it talk about the widow standing around Peter, showing them the robes and other clothing that Dorcas had made? Now, this is a reminder, really, for those of you that are single out there, whether you have always been single or whether you're widowed or divorced, you know, don't let your situation or where you are stop you using your gifts and serving God. In Bible times, if you weren't married or if you didn't have a male sponsor, you were really disadvantaged and marginalized. This is why often women formed groups together to survive. And in fact, the early church consisted of many of these groups. There was something perhaps that did put a little strain on the church resources sometimes, as Paul speaks about the widows being treated fairly in the church in his letters. However, they also contributed to the church. So remember also, for a start, there were no clothing factories in those days. In fact, the word didn't even exist. Dorcas was able to make much clothing, and this would have brought in money, but also she obviously gave them away and helped clothe the poor. Now, you know, Dorcas or Tabitha is one of those unsung heroines. In fact, she was a normal person. She got on with what she could do best and did it to the glory of God. She lived a life of faith and hope whilst bearing the sorrows of life. You know, I know plenty of Dorcases. I know plenty of Dorcases in our church, male and female. People who press on through the troubles of life, serving quietly with the gifts God has given them. Never really being acknowledged, never often spoken about perhaps, and never very often brought onto the stage. I just want to thank you all. If you're one of those, and I know there are many, I want to thank you for that. And God sees it, God knows. And look at what happened to Dorcas. No, in a good way. I know she died, but never mind. What else? Dorcas did her deeds in secret. She did not do anything heroic like Deborah or risky like Rahab, but she's in the scriptures. She simply served her Saviour by ministering to the marginalised. The needs of people moved her to action. She was not lazy. She knitted clothes for people. The Bible says that she was full of good works. You know, sometimes there are people full of good words, but actually, there's not many works that comes out, you know. Here's a quote from Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. What she did is make herself beautiful, in fact. It wasn't her fancy clothes. It was her fruit of compassion. I hope we'll be known as a church full of compassion. Helping each other, helping the poor, feeding those in need, in whatever way, including through the food bank. Although you need staff to run a food bank, don't you? You know, what about assisting with those in debt? Looking forward to our CMA ministry developing. Blessing people with random acts of kindness. All those of you that made cakes and have blessed our local schools in the months and weeks recently and helped out. These things speak louder in our society today than many other things. People won't necessarily listen to our sermons or come to our church, but they will work with and they'll listen to you when you get onto their level and you help them. You go where they are and bring that gift of life and God's Spirit and the name of Jesus into there. Now, you can't help everybody, but you can help someone. Tabitha always did good. She had a heart to help the hurting and hopeless. Remember, widows didn't have any social security or pensions back then. If they were to be cared for, it was a family or church that did so. You know, Tabitha was a seamstress. She's really a picture of almost Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, 19, 20 says, in her hand she holds the distaff, grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. That was Tabitha. You know, small things done with great love can change the world. Small things done with great love can do the impossible and change the world. Reminded of this scripture from 1 Peter 4. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. As we serve, the church is strengthened. Now, Dorcas is the only woman called a disciple in the Bible. She's the only woman in the New Testament explicitly identified as a disciple. This title wasn't given to Mary or Martha or any other woman. And remember, the word disciple means learner, a follower, one who is determined to be like his or her teacher. This could be used of Tabitha, of Dorcas. It's incredible. Ladies, the Bible uses really strong language for its time. This is really countercultural stuff. A woman wasn't allowed really to be a disciple in one of those days. But look what we've got here. And what a reminder we have that Jesus came to uplift the downtrodden, to set the captives free. This passage also reminds us a little bit of that bad things do happen to good people. the Old Testament, I know sometimes errs on talking about good people being saved and everything and the wicked being destroyed. And we know that in Christ we are blessed with many things on earth and for eternity, but we still know bad things happen to good people. Now, it never seems right when good people, godly people, suffer and die. And we've seen amazing Christian people die far too early. Now, God knows this. And we have to be reminded that we don't know the full picture. We think it's best if we have them here. But actually, this world perhaps isn't as nice as the next one. We just have to remember that our Saviour is Jesus. You know, and He was a perfect person, and look at how He suffered. We don't know why some of us have more pain than others or die earlier than others, but we do know that God knows. God knows the hairs on our head, the days allotted to us. He knows, and we just got to trust Him. So the disciples in Joppa called for Peter. It's interesting, isn't it, how God raises some and God keeps some. I wonder why Dorcas was raised from the dead while someone like Stephen was not. He was publicly martyred in Jerusalem. Seems to me that it would have been really powerful, wouldn't it, if he had been brought to life. Imagine that, in a very public way in a capital city. But he wasn't. And yet here's a quiet woman raised to life in a private upper room in a small town. Why was she raised? Was it because she was a great teacher that could never be replaced? Was she a huge financial contributor? Was she a miracle worker? Don't think so. I think she was raised, perhaps, because God doesn't want compassion to die. God doesn't want the compassion to die in the church. James 1:27. As this quite bold statement, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Interesting, isn't it? Compassion. Do we show compassion? I hope we do. It's interesting also that Dorcas was appreciated, but after her life. Why is this? We do have a tendency, don't we, to honour people only after they're dead. Look at Prince Philip, all that came out about what he's done over the years. Fantastic stuff. Actually, why couldn't we remember that before he died? Why don't we remember people when they're alive and appreciate them in life? What will people show after your death? For Dorcas, they brought clothes. Now, sadly, for some people, after they die, what will come out will be not very nice things. Either gossips or liars or cheats or personalities that were stubborn and unforgiving. But as these women surrounded people, Peter, they put Tabitha's deeds on display by pointing to their own clothing. The phrase robes and other clothing in the original language refers both to their undergarments and their outerwear. Tabitha had made everything they were wearing. They were literally clothed in her compassion. What will people show after you die? What does she do after she was resurrected? We don't hear any more about what happens next. But I'm not sure. I don't think she went on a speaking tour. I'm convinced that probably after she regained her strength, she went right back to her quiet and unassuming service. You know, miracles, real godly miracles, always magnify God and work to spread the good news of His glory. When you hear of someone claiming a miracle and all they're doing is focusing on themselves, your guard should go up. Verse 42 said, "This became known all over Joppa, and many people believed in the Lord." We often worry, don't we, how we're going to get the word out about Jesus Christ. You know, interesting, isn't it? Word gets around really quickly when something messes up, doesn't it? Everyone will know. Everyone will know. However, do you know that word also does get around quickly when God uses you in a powerful way? Dorcas served, she suffered. but was used by God, an example of what happened to Jesus, really, and what the Holy Spirit can ultimately accomplish. It's beautiful, this part of Scripture. Beautiful what we see here happening in the name of Jesus. What about Peter's perspective a little bit before we finish? Peter here was dealing with the impossible. A man paralyzed first for 8 years. What does he do? What does he do? He confidently commands the name of Jesus Christ over and tells him to get up. Awesome. Awesome. Love to see that, hey? But what about when it comes to Dorcas? Now, this is real the next level stuff, isn't it? It's not just someone who's been ill for a while or paralyzed. Dorcas had died. It's impossible. So what does he do? Well, he, give him credit, he has seen a little bit of that. He's seen Jesus raise people to life, and he's seen obviously Jesus being raised to life as well. But it, now it's him turn, it's real flesh and blood, and he's the only one there. What does he do when he faces the impossible? Well, I think there's five things that he does. Let's have a quick look at it, shall we? First of all, do you notice he finds a quiet place, just like Jesus did? He cleared out the mourners, the noisy place, sent out the crowd. You know, it reminds us everyone may sing your praises, but not everyone can bring you a miracle. Peter had to put some people out of the room. They would be detractors. They may have meant well, but they would take away something from the miracle. You know, sometimes you have to do that. You have to get things out of the situation. You have to move things or people out for God to work. Possibly, I don't know, they didn't believe. They wouldn't. Perhaps they were, I don't know, gossips and the complainers. I don't know, but they had to be moved out. Can God do something in your situation? Or are you too surrounded with negativity and non-belief, perhaps? Do we need to move one or two things aside so we can see God work in the miraculous? What else? Number two, Peter engaged with the Father in prayer, didn't he? He clears everyone out. He gets quiet. He gets on his knees and he prays to the Father. I bet he prays. I'd love to hear his words. What do I do now, God? What do I do? Or may we do the same when we face the impossible. May we find the quiet, clear the distractions, and engage with the Father. What else? Number three, well, Peter is confident in his identity and with his spiritual authority. And isn't he? He knows who he is in Christ. He knows the power he has with the Holy Spirit. And we need to be confident in our identity as Christians, as people full of the Holy Spirit. We need to have that spiritual authority that's invested. If you follow Christ, if you allow him into your heart, if you want to serve him, be open to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives you that authority to speak in the name of Jesus. If it's in his will, in his time, and we'll see amazing thing. It's invested in us for that reason. So spending time with the Father reminds us of this. And this is what Jesus adopted as well, didn't he? He took himself off with the Father. And then we often saw amazing things come. So Peter is confident in his identity and with his spiritual authority. Four, we need to face the challenge head on. Do you see how Peter speaks with authority and calls things not yet as they are? As he speaks to the woman. You know what I mean? He's basically, he starts to say things that are not currently happening as if they are. He speaks to her to get up before she's alive. Peter faced the challenge head on. He didn't run away with it. He didn't mess about with it. Situation. He faced the challenge head on. He cleared out, engaged with the Father. He's confident in his authority, and he spoke to Tabitha and said, get up. Now, number five, He speaks about what has been done. Peter invites back all the widows to show them that the woman is now alive. So to conclude, what are you facing today? Do you desire to be someone different, to have other giftings? Look at Tabitha or Dorcas. Are you facing situations that are impossible? Work problems, I know, financial problems, health problems. Let us learn from Dorcas and Peter's example. Let us, I'll go through that one more time again. First of all, be content to live a life using our gifts for the glory of God. Let us not be concerned for what we do not have. Two, let us serve others in whatever way we can. Now, when the impossible comes, what do? Well, we find a quiet place, clear out the unbelief. We engage with the Father in prayer. We need to be confident about our identity and spiritual authority that's invested in us. We need to face the challenge head on. And then finally, we need to speak about what has been done. And finish just with this word of scripture. And the words of Jesus from Matthew 19:26. Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Remember that, folks. Remember that. We are installed with the power that Peter has too. Let us be Jesus. Let us be his workers wherever he places us. And let us see those miracles roll on. Amen.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. Generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus.
So, may the lost be found, the dead be raised, in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live loud, our God will save, we believe, we believe. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word today. Amen. God bless, look after yourselves, take care, and see you next time.